Forbidden Honey Dew Chronicles. Book 2. Balor's Reign and the Dungeons of Britnoitula. This is a work of entertainment fiction. Any similarities to actual persons, places, or events are coincidental. Chapter 2. Bill meets Jay on the way out of the building and walk onto the streets of Elmore City, Oklahoma. It was once a comically named rural town, but now it has grown to a population of over 500,000. The street scene is filled with incredibly boring high-rise apartment buildings that all look exactly the same. There are no trees nor grass anywhere near the sidewalks. If it weren't for the sky, you would think that you were at a gigantic indoor mall. The buildings are so hard to tell apart that you need to read the number on the building to know when you're home, if you would even call it a home. Jay and Bill reach one of the buildings on Shirley Street. The front door to the building is locked and has a panel with a scanning device. Jay pulls a card out of his pocket and waves it in front of the scanning device. It beeps and the door clicks. Jay opens the door and Bill comes with him into the entry lobby. A computer voice speaks. Guest detected. No OCS chip. Present identification for record. Jay says, your card? Bill pulls a card out of his pocket and waves it before the scanning device. The voice from the computer says, pursuant to the terms of the lease, guest visits are limited to 2 hours. Please be advised that any extension of the time limit will be charged a fine of $100 per minute. Please don't forget to have your guests scan their identification upon exit, lest ye be levied the maximum fine of $15,000, of which all residents over the age of 18 shall be joint and severally liable. Jay and Bill ride the elevator to floor 71 of the high-rise and walk down a long hall past 17 doors. The walls, floor, and ceiling are all dull off-white, as well as the doors. All the lighting is very bright fluorescent with lots of flicker. There are video cameras everywhere. Jay waves his card at the door. They enter the apartment. It's about a third of the size of a what we used to call a cheap motel room. There is no furniture except for 3 camp cot mattresses. It would be too crowded to hang out in if it had a real bed anyway. They have no large personal belongings, just tiny laptop computers, some clothes, and cheap canned food. There is a video camera in the ceiling. In front of the camera is taped a photograph of the room as it is when nobody's there. There is a bar magnet taped to its microphone. Jay says, I almost never see my mom and dad. Both of them work 3 jobs and are still flat broke after the rent. We can only even eat because of the food stamps. And of course, everyone gives us a hard time about using them. They changed what they call them a long time ago. I know, but we find the term supplemental nutritional assistance to be even more insulting, not to mention more awkward to say. It almost sounds like it's force-feeding beets or something. And, as you can see, the management control the hell out of us in our own home to boot. We don't keep much because we are forced to move every few months. My dad's boss is a billionaire, has a very spacious house, and even though he rents, what he pays for that is about half of what our rent costs, and it's all because he has perfect credit. He also owns stock in all the companies that run these apartment buildings. I fear the day when I turn 18, when I will be forced to sign all those contracts that my parents already do. I can't count the times I saw my mom break down and cry and gnash her teeth in terror, her face turning hot white, while the building management agents smirk at her without a hint of any kind of empathy or remorse. They write these contracts in such a way that no matter how careful you are, some kind of accidental violation of the contract is outright inevitable. It's total walking on eggshells. Fair as baseball, one hit and caught ball and you're out. Pushed around from one rental company to another, they go through this process over and over and over again. And the more evictions on the credit report, the more they hike up the prices. No, we never got behind on rent. It's always for them nitpicking over the rules. I think I'd rather go on the run from the civilized world or even die than have to live like that. I'm not looking forward to high school graduation at all. One time an ambulance had to be called when my mom had a heart attack during the lease signing ritual.
The doctor signed the lease for her using a temporary incapacity power of attorney. Then the management sent her a letter. The letter said, "Please be advised that you will be held accountable as if you had signed the contract willingly in wholehearted agreement." Wholehearted agreement? Interesting choice of words, as those who write these forms don't seem to have even half a heart. Everyone knows people are being forced to sign these things. They didn't really need to change contract law that much when we converted to a monarchy, as there had already been plenty of coercion by collusion in what was called the free market era. My parents have been sued for the rest of the year's rent after getting kicked out 4 times, and as a result went through 2 bankruptcies. And, of course, the more bad stuff that's on the credit report, the more nitpicky they get when we're trying to get another place. They bring up every false charge that all the past landlords wrote about us as if their words were the effing gospel of for crying out loud. Eventually, we'll have no choice but to just let them lock us up. I can't imagine how the chattel slavery of the pre-Civil War era could have been much worse than this. At least those slaves weren't sent filling out applications to beg for a new slave owner to accept them every few months under deadline pressures. When my mom and dad try to seek a lawyer for help with our rights, they always change the subject to rights and responsibilities. It's quite clear that the lawyers work for them, not us, but they are willing to take our money and give us patronizing education. Real advocacy for the downtrodden does not seem to exist in the lawyer business anymore. Bill knows that Jay is often making trouble and could just be mouthing off. However, many of the very same things are starting to happen to his own family, and it is gradually getting worse. Jay is cooking some toast in the toaster and watching it closely. I have to be very careful. The smoke detector doesn't just beep, and there's no stop button. The computer force evacuates the whole building every time someone burns their toast. And you better do exactly what you're supposed to, or else. It goes on record with the lease enforcement department if they catch you saving any of your own personal belongings. Yes, they actually have 2 full-time employees with lease enforcement specialist as their job title, and they are offered overtime pay generously. Nobody who lives here dares to look them in the eye for any reason. Most turn off the radio or TV and hide in the bathroom when the sound of their high heels is heard as they patrol the halls. About the only thing missing is the Korean army's high-kicking march style. People have learned to be extremely cautious, but a big alarm and follow-up interrogation happens about once a week. How's your family's place? Pretty much the same thing. It's on Arrowhead Drive. But if you didn't check the number and street name, you would not be able to tell our buildings apart, inside or out. Not much of a home when you just can't wait to get out of it. Only legal place to sleep, shower, and cook a meal. Otherwise, we really live on the streets. That's what we get for nearly my parents' entire income. We barely have enough to put 6 quarters in the shower each time we use it, and it only runs for 40 seconds. It works like a self-service car wash bay. My dad can only afford to take a shower 2 times a week on this machine and has to hide this fact from his bosses. My mom and dad would say, at least the work bosses are not as bossy as the landlords. When it rains, Dad would take a walk with his shirt off just to get some free body cleaning from nature's gift, although he has to watch out for the bugs, especially the flying scorpions. He gets really shaky from the fear when he gets home on the 3rd day since his last shower. Mom doesn't have that option. She gets a bad rash if she doesn't wash at least every 2 days. Jay and Bill pack some suitcases. Jay says, "Shh," waves his hand between the camera and decoy picture while he pulls the picture and magnet off of the camera and hides them in his backpack. They leave the building, waving their cards to the computer to report their exit. As they are walking, Bill says, "Whoa," Jay cuts in, "Shh, wait till we're on the outskirts of town." 2 hours walking west on Route 29, Jay says, "We're almost there. What a shame that my parents pay most of their wages for not only a miserable excuse for a home, but one we literally avoid as much as possible. That's one of the reasons I go to sleepover parties so much. By the way, the magnet jams the microphone so they can't hear us talking." "I know, we're doing the same thing. Although they don't know about the camera trick. I hope not to ever be in their shoes. I'm also seriously considering just going on the run when I come of age. If I try to do everything right and will be treated like a criminal anyway for some slight inevitable imperfection, what's the point? If there is any place to run left in the whole world, that is. By the way, this party will be quite historic. Rick is about to reveal his top secret invention. I can't wait to see it. They arrive at an abandoned motel. Japanese knotweed is eating away at its walls. Beetles, mice, ants, and rats scurry about the foundation. There are no cars near the building. The windows are all boarded up. It is quiet. Jay says, "Here's the place. Nobody's home but the rats and the beetles? Only looks that way. We keep it very discreet. Come in quickly."